people started like bringing their notebook with them on stage, and it became like a sign of, I'm this kind of comedian.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, wait a minute. It's not wrong to memorize your act. Right.
This is What a Joke
with Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster.
Dana came on my Come to Papa show at Largo. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's just, you know, it's a variety show kind of thing. And it's just sketches and stuff. And I really think about this all the time because I really respect you as a comedian. You've always been one of those guys that I've always just looked up to.
Yeah, but I was always one of those guys you wondered why I wasn't bigger.
No, you were always like, it's just so killer. And he was holding the script and we were just at Largo. And I hand him the sketch and the script. And he's just like, I just appreciate when people actually do the goddamn work.
It's true. Yeah. It's true.
And it really meant a lot because it does take a lot to write those things.
Yeah, and put it does. Them in it's this, and, but I tell, you know, this is your job.
Right.
You know, I remember like the notebook that comedians would bring on stage. Remember, like that's, I was there when that started, like in the LA alternative scene.
Yeah.
This is like inside baseball comedy. Nonsense.
That's why we're here.
We had a show called On Cabaret, and there was another show we did at a place called Big and Tall Books, and this is like me and Janeane and David Cross and Bob Odenkirk and all of that, and right. Kathy Griffin and all of that crew,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. All that group,
the pioneers.
Yeah, that's right. We all had coonskin caps,
covered wagon,
paid in pelts, but. The thing was, you couldn't do material that you'd done before. It had to be new.
Right.
And we were all procrastinators because we're comedians, so we would write it that day.
Right.
And then you would go on stage with your notebook because you'd just written it.
Yeah.
And then people started like bringing their notebook with them on stage, and it became like a sign of, I'm this kind of comedian.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, wait a minute. It's not wrong to memorize your act.
Right. Yeah, and then it became a thing of like people doing their old stuff but having the notebook up there like just in case it didn't work.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Chelsea, Amy Carter's in the news. It's okay to memorize. It's okay to memorize your act.
How long did you work on The Simpsons?
About 8 years, 7-8 years.
Yeah, I thought it was a good run.
It was a good stretch.
Man, what was that room like?
It was interesting. It is, you know, 12 or 13 of the funniest people in the world, but they don't, it's not like I was the only one that was a professional comedian.
Right.
And it's a bunch of very educated, at the time, very educated guys and one woman. And now it's, you know, that was back in the early aughts.
Right.
It's much more diverse, as right. it should be.
Yeah.
We caught up. But it's just like the funniest people in the world. But it's not like I had comedian energy. Like I was,
right.
You know, like a Muppet.
Yeah.
And then you'd get these, like George Meyer was the guy that I just was fascinated with. Because
why?
He's just like this, you know, guy who was tough. Kind of tall, skinny guy, and he always wore like a golf cap. And one night we were sitting there, and we had it's called a Rube Goldberg, where like Homer falls off the top of a building and he hits a balcony, and then he hits a flagpole, and then he hits a awning, and then you know it's just, and it was boom, 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 boom.
Right.
But we didn't know how to end it, and literally like. There's like two rooms of six people, and then the one room of six people, and the other room lets out, so they all wander in and check out the kitchen before they leave.
Right.
Like, what are you guys doing? We're trying to solve this. So one by one, like everybody came in, and we had everybody in the room for like 2 hours, just people staring at the ceiling, wondering how to end this joke.
Yeah.
And we had everything that we'd done, but we're like, he lands on a dump truck, and then the dump truck, blah, 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 yeah, we did that. Da, 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 da. And finally, George just goes, you know, he's just sitting there quietly, and he just goes, all right, what if Homer lands in a dump truck that's carrying marshmallow fluff and he's safe and he kind of sighs, and then a bunch of scorpions come out of the fluff and start stinging him? And I'm like, I would not have thought of that.
Right?
And that's what we did. You know, he's just like, the way he thought. He was the one that wrote one of my favorite lines, which was, my cat's breath smells like cat food. Ralph Wiggum. And there was just and it took me it took me 9 months to figure out how to write the show.
Yeah,
like, yeah.
Because the joke algorithms are not traditional.
Right.
It's like you're what it is like you write a joke.
Yeah.
That's a normal joke.
Yeah.
And that joke becomes the setup to the real joke. It's like,
oh, interesting.
Really?
It's a step ahead. Yeah. It's a step ahead.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. It was fun.
God,
I could have stayed
run.
There and I'd have a lot more money, but I'd weigh 400 pounds and be clinically depressed.
Oh.
Did it get depressing?
Well, it just it's for me, for my own, like I was.
Yeah, it's a weird thing.
Well, I missed performing.
Right.
I missed.
Right.
You know, you can't do anything. I mean, it was the best experience of my career.
Sure.
And like I started working on the show a month before I got married, and then I left the show and I had, you know, a house and a family and,
right.
you know, children. It's like I kind of became an adult
right.
Working on the show. And so I'm very grateful to it.
But it's all consuming. It had to have been.
You can't do anything else. You're there 10 to 6, 7, 8.
Yeah.
And you're thinking really hard.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you'd get, and you like, you want to go do a set after? No.
No.
I think the longest I ever went without doing a set was 6 weeks, but I really
right.
missed doing sets, and I could feel myself getting worse as a comedian. Like I could feel myself.
Yeah.
Like missing a step and it's like Joel Hodgson described it as like being a surfer on the beach without a board.
Right.
You know, and you just, I didn't like it.
Yeah. Did you feel like you were changing as a person because you weren't performing
all
the time?
Oh, yeah, totally. I felt like,
it's all of a sudden you're like, wait, who am I?
No, that's funny you say that. I was at a, when it was getting, you know, after, you know, about 6, 7 years, I was really like, I don't know. I don't feel like myself anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
I was at a party and somebody said, "Are you Dana Gould?" And I said, "I used to be."
Right.
And my wife said, "I think you got to go."
Yeah. Yeah.
And I didn't realize she meant she wanted a divorce.
She's like, "I'm going to." Bye bye.
No, but it's a heavy, it's a heavy thing. It's,
yeah. Well, you know what it's. Well, you, yeah. I mean, you're a comedian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're a comedian. You know, you're a comedian that acts and writes and has a show.
Yeah.
Sirius, but you're a comedian first.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And everything else that you do kind of flow. It's doing, getting on stage and telling jokes.
Yeah.
Is the nuclear rod that powers
right.
the rest of your
100%.
Creativity.
Yeah.
And, and it's because it's such a pure thing. And,
yeah.
And what I love is as you go through your career, if you stay engaged, that it continues to do that.
Right.
And you get your niche, and that's great. That's all I want. Like, yeah, I do this thing. I have fans. I have a little podcast.
Yeah.
I have work, and you just keep doing it.
Keep making stuff.
Yeah. Keep making stuff, and doing comedy allows you to do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, you could tell. I mean, because now that, you know, you're not in the you're not on staff.
No.
You're doing stand-up. You and I followed each other at Montreal.
Yeah.
I followed you at Montreal. We had each had an hour show.
Right.
And I was backstage. I got there early and I watched your whole set. And it was just like, oh, he's totally firing on all cylinders.
Oh, it was, yeah.
This is like.
And you feel great. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's cool to see that from that, like you say, like the nuclear.
Yeah,
I mean, because you're popping off with all these things now. You did Stand vs. Evil. You've got the podcast.
Yeah, well, you have
the Planet of the Apes thing. You really did a graphic novel, by the way.
Every shameful thing.
It's so great.
I just, as Bobcat always says, Dana, you're more obscure. Your career's not obscure enough. But yeah, no, I did write that. But then it was like Rod Serling's my hero. Like I grew up like you, I'm sure, like watching The Twilight Zone.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And then what I didn't realize, though, is, you know, Rod Serling's first draft is 165 pages.
Ooh.
And with a graphic novel, you know, dialogue has to fit in a balloon, and
yeah.
you get one action a panel, and you get 4 to 7 panels a page.
Yeah.
And so every day I would get up and sit down at the computer and edit Rod Serling.
That's great.
That's the horrible thing.
That's so great,
this
though.
Angry smoking ghost behind me. Why are you cutting that? That's good. Yeah. What are you doing?
Yeah. What are you thinking, Serling?
Yeah, yeah. Why are you cutting that?
That's amazing.
Yeah. But so that was.
And people can get that. We can get that.
Yeah. It's called Planet of the Apes Visionaries, and it's by on Boom Comics. And
very
it's,
cool.
It's at your comic. It's at your. Your popular comic book store.
Your local comic book.
You know, America has, every town in America has a comic book store.
Yeah.
Not every town in America has a bookstore.